Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for this very special episode of Character Building. I'm Lauren Kennedy Brady. I'm the producing artistic director here at Theatre Raleigh. We're really happy that you're supporting live theater by watching our virtual theater experiences. So thank you for joining tonight. And while you're with us, if you want to subscribe to our YouTube channel, we are so close to 1,000 subscribers. Okay, we're only at like 818, but we're getting there, and that's pretty cool for us. So subscribe, and we'll tell you about all the cool things we have going on, all the cool shows we have coming up, not only virtually, but also in person. We also would ask that if you feel compelled to donate to Theatre Raleigh, we would love to have your help. We are getting ready to go back and start production this summer, fingers crossed. But we are still struggling to make it through, and any little bit that you can do would be greatly appreciated. Instead of selling tickets for these virtual performances, we're asking for donations. So you go over to Theatre Raleigh if you'd like and donate, not only to Theatre Raleigh, but all the arts organizations in your area or in our area. Make sure you're supporting the arts during this time. And I would be incredibly remiss if I did not thank our virtual theater experience sponsor. That is First Citizens. They have completely nailed it during this time and supported us with all of this programming. Not only Character Building, but our reunion specials and Living Room Live. So thank you very, very much, First Citizens, for helping us out. Okay, so we have Broadway icon with us tonight. She's a Tony winner, a Grammy and Emmy nominee. She is the queen of all things, really, when it comes right down to it. I cannot wait to have this conversation with her and catch up. Ladies and gentlemen, here she is, Betty Buckley. Hey! Hi, Betty!
Hi, Lauren. So good to see you.
Oh, my God! I'm so happy to see you. Thank you so much for doing this with me tonight.
Thank you for inviting me. This is great.
God, we're going to have so much fun. I cannot wait to catch up. It has been, I don't know, many years since I've seen you.
Yeah.
I was saying before, I feel like tonight is the night I'm going to ask you all the questions that I wanted to ask you when we did Sunset Boulevard together 25 or 6 years ago. So just be prepared.
Was it that long? Oh, my God.
I mean, I was 21. Now I'm 47. So there you go. That's remedial math, so.
But yeah, you look the same. You look exactly the same.
I don't know about that.
That's true. You look beautiful. I'm so happy to see you. And to find out about the theater that you've created in Raleigh, it's so amazing. It's fabulous.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, it's been this weird sort of second career that I never really dreamed about having. You know, when I was a kid, I dreamed about being Betty Buckley. I didn't dream about running a theater. Seriously, though, and I didn't think for a minute I would do anything else besides just, you know, wanting to star in a Broadway show. And then, of course, things happen as you grow
life
up.
Life happens.
I just got this new love, and I feel like it's the thing I was meant to do in a weird way. So it's very exciting.
It's so exciting. I've been watching your interviews, too. They're great.
Thank you. Thank you. You did a little prep work yourself. Well, I did lots of research on you, even though I feel like I knew a lot of it anyway. normally on this show, we talk through like your career. So it's like, Betty Buckley, you have had an incredible career. You were able to bounce back and forth between Broadway and TV and film in a way that like most people aspire to, but never have that kind of success in both mediums.
Thank you. Thanks.
So I'm so fascinated. You made your Broadway debut in 1776, correct? There you are.
Yes.
Look at that cutie pie playing the violin.
<That's> funny. That hairstyle.
Oh my gosh. It's like 1776, but kind of 1969 at the same time.
Yes, very. That's a great way to describe it.
It's so funny how, like, the real time it actually was always kind of comes through, even though it's period.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you did Pippin as well, right? Was that your follow-up to 1776?
No, I went to London for a year and did Promises, Promises after I did 1776 for 7 months.
Oh,
then I was
gosh.
In London for a year and played Fran Kubelik in Promises, Promises.
Oh, my God.
And then
God,
I came back into 1776, and then I did some Off-Broadway things. And then I did Pippin.
Well, like I said,
I was in Pippin forever.
You were? How long did you do it?
2 years and 8 months.
Oh my God, that's
it
a
was
long
insane.
Run.
Oh, it was ridiculous. But I was making so little money that I needed to keep the job so I could pay for my acting classes and my therapy, you know, so that was really important.
God. Well, it probably ended up being a little bit of a day job where you were auditioning for other things and kind of doing your, you know, whatever the hustle was at that point
exactly.
as well.
Mm-hmm.
I remember calling, like, you know, your dressing room in Midtown. I remember calling it my office. So I'd be like at auditions during the day, and then I'd go hang out in my dressing room and then go to another audition and then come to the show at night. Anyway, so what was next? I'm probably getting this chronologically incorrect, but of course I remember you from Eight is Enough. I watched it like every week. There you are with
show.
Dick Van Patten. Oh my God, so good. How did that gig come about?
Well, after Pippin, I did the film. I left Pippin and did the film Carrie.
Interesting.
You know, I went out to Hollywood for the first time and shot Carrie, played Miss Collins, the gym teacher.
There
with,
you are.
You know, directed by Brian De Palma. And,
I mean,
and yeah, that was my first movie. And then from that film, the TV show Eight is Enough, the beautiful Diana Hyland, who played the original mother on the show, had passed away very unexpectedly from cancer. And so they were auditioning everybody to play the stepmother, a new stepmother person on the show. And Brandon Tartikoff, who later ran NBC, I think, for a number of years, he was the assistant to Fred Silverman at ABC.
Wow.
And he said he thought that this character, Miss Collins, in the film Carrie, would be the exact prototype for the new stepmother, Abby. And so they flew me out to LA twice to do a screen test. My first screen test didn't go well. They flew me back because Brandon Tartikoff was so sure that I was the right person. Thankfully, he's why I got the job. And so they hired their best director to come in and shoot my second test. And then I got the show and I was in that for 4 years, which was a bit of a shock.
Incredible. Oh my God. All those children, Dick Van Patten and you. I was just, my memory mainly is that I was obsessed with like Willie Ames and all of the boys, right? Like
yeah,
I had all
yeah.
the Teen Beat magazines where they were
yeah.
on the cover.
They were so cute, really cute.
That's so funny. So then after you did Carrie and then Eight is Enough, what was next for you? Was that right about the time you got Cats? I mean,
I did one of my hiatuses from Eight is Enough. I think it was the summer of my third season. I did Getting My Together and Taking It on the Road in the city at the Circle in the Square downtown. And from that, I then was cast in Getting My Together and did it at the Huntington Hartford in LA for 6 months. So I was doing Eight is Enough in the daytime and the show at night. And then found out through the grapevine that our show was canceled. Like they didn't even have the courtesy to call and tell us. So that was really weird. So I was still in LA for a bit longer doing Getting My Act Together. And this wonderful producer, Fred Roos, who was also a brilliant casting mind in Hollywood. He was Francis Coppola's main producer and he produced The Black Stallion, which is one of my favorite movies among many other Coppola movies. So he had seen me in Getting My Act Together in New York and called me into his office and said that he really thought I was a good actress and that he was going to see to it that I worked in film. So he kept trying to get me in to meet with Coppola while I was doing Eight is Enough and Getting My Act Together at night. And we could never coordinate our schedules. And so he called me that summer that I was still living in LA after the show was finished, Eight is Enough, and said, there's a new film called Tender Mercies, written by Horton Foote, who's one of the great American playwrights. And it's starring Robert Duvall. And the part is of a country Western singing star who's an alcoholic. I've recommended one person go get the part, and which was an amazing gift that he gave me. And so I went in and I met with Bruce Beresford. It was the greatest audition I've ever had. He said, Beresford, who I was a huge fan of because he'd done Breaker Morant, among other Australian films. He said, can you sing? And I said, yes. And he said, can you sing country Western? And I said, yes, I'm from Texas. And he said, can you act? I said, yes. And he said, do you want this part? And I was like, yes. And that was it.
You just checked all the boxes. This. Boom, boom, boom.
I was like, okay, I'm ready to go.
Oh, my God. I love that. That's so incredible. So Tender Mercies, that is an amazing film. It's such a stunning film. Your performance, Robert Duvall's performance.
Thank you.
Just incredible.
So we shot that the following winter. And in the meantime, I had gone through this audition process with Katz. And this was like, I think, the summer and then the fall of 1981. And so they didn't like me at the first audition for Katz. And my agent said, that you're a tall Texas girl and you radiate health and well-being, and we're looking for someone who's small and radiates death and dying. And I said, they'll be back, to my agent. Her name was Joanna Ross, and she was like, why do you say that? And I said, because it's my turn. I just have a feeling about this part.
And so they'll be back.
It was funny. I just really felt it really strongly. And so 6 months later, she called and said, they want to see you again on Wednesday for Cats. And so I went in and sang again and was cast. So it was quite a process.
That's incredible. I love that you had that kind of foresight of like, no, they're wrong. It's actually going to be mine. It's fine.
Well, I everywhere I went to, Lauren, I kept seeing little cat figurines. Like, I was looking for a new apartment, and I went into this apartment, and there were like cat things everywhere. And I was like, this is a sign.
See? Duh. Duh. So, oh my God, that is amazing. Well,
yeah.
And it's so iconic. I mean, you are so iconic, and your voice was so special in that. How could they have ever even considered anybody
Thank
else?
You. Thank you.
Well, unbelievable.
They didn't get it at the beginning, and I was like, dudes, it's my turn.
Trevor Nunn, wake up.
It was pretty funny.
And then, of course, I don't know, we're probably fast-forwarding a lot. Mm-hmm. I don't want to skip this.
So what I was going to tell you is we opened in Cats October of 1982, and then Tender Mercies came out following that.
Oh my God.
That was a pretty big year.
That's pretty exciting time for you.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, were you just really overwhelmed? Oh my God. Well, so I want to get into all of that kind of stuff later, because so much of what I want to understand is how somebody who's at that level and having so much input, and you're the Tony Awards and you're at movie premieres and things like that, like, how did you manage that? It must have been so, so exciting, but also so intense. Anyway, let's circle back to that.
Okay.
But I want to talk about Drood for a minute, the Mystery of Edwin Drood, because I used to sing The Writing on the Wall all the time. That was like a song that I sang in college a lot. And I got to play the part actually here at my own theater a few years ago.
Oh, awesome. I'd like to see you play that.
Oh, it was so fun. But Betty, I will tell you, so Rupert Holmes actually came here to work on it with us because we did a 90-minute version of it. So they did like a truncated kind of smaller cast version.
And
we worked
on
here, which was really cool. But he was like, do you want to sing it in the Betty Buckley key or the Stephanie Block key? I was like, oh, Betty Buckley key, Betty Buckley all day long. But then in my first day of rehearsal, I was like, I cracked on the top note. I was like, I guess not.
I can't
do the Betty Buckley key. I wanted to so bad. It was like, oh, I could do it when I was young, but, you know, 45, not so much.
I couldn't do it either.
No, oh, my God. But how cool, what an amazing show, what a cool experience.
I think that was one of the greatest work experiences I've ever had. I mean, it was truly, I'm sorry, my glasses keep fogging up. It was truly one of the, I don't know what to say. It was so joyous. And the cast was one of the greatest casts I've ever worked with. And I have to say, I think our cast album is one of the greatest Broadway cast albums in history. It's so impeccably done. I mean, it's just
really
beautiful.
Was. You're not
and
kidding.
I got to, you know, work with just the Howard Magillan.
Howard,
I mean, when we sang Two Kinsmen on stage, I just thought I had died and gone to heaven. It was like our voices were just like ringing in space. It was so great. And then Patty Cohenhauer, who played Rosebud, her soprano is just so impeccably beautiful. And I just, every rehearsal, every performance, I would just work like crazy just to match her tone and, you know, for our harmonies and stuff. And I learned so much just working with them all. They were amazing. And then, of course, George Rose and Cleo Lane and John Arara and the whole group was just an amazing, beautiful cast. Joe Grafossi was in the show. He's a brilliant character actor, and he gave me lessons each day in rehearsal about how to play a boy. You know, we were just like, we're doing one thing today, Betty, just one thing. Today we'll focus on the walk. Tomorrow we'll focus on how we hold the cigar. You know, it's just like so great.
So cool. Yeah, but I love, too, that it's the show within a show, which is also so fun, too, that you're actually Alice Nutting playing Edwin Drood. So
yeah,
you got
playing
to play
the old super man Datchery, right?
Yes, so exactly, Datchery. Yeah. Oh, it was so fun. And you're not kidding about that cast album. I mean, it's like I can hear it in my head right now. I've listened to it so many times. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's perfect. It's really good.
And then of course, you revisited Carrie and did it on Broadway for how many performances? Three?
No, it was longer than that. It was like, I think it was 2 weeks, right?
It was a limited run. But there
we
you
did,
are.
And we did some previews, and then we opened, and then that was short.
And then it didn't go maybe as planned, but
that was an amazing work situation too with Lindsay Haley. Oh my God, she was amazing. She was 17, making her Broadway debut, and boy, howdy, that was fun. Super good.
Oh my God, amazing. So what was it about Carrie that made you want to revisit it and then in a different role as the mother this time?
Well, I have a long history with that. Do you want to hear the whole story or just part of it?
I mean, let's hear it.
Well, I'm very close friends with Dean Pitchford, you know, who wrote the lyrics. Mm-hmm. And I was actually his date to the Oscars when he won for Fame. And we're good friends. And he was my first Pippin on Broadway because he was John Rubinstein's standby when I went into the show to replace Jill Clayburgh. And so we're very, very good friends. And Larry Cohen wrote the screenplay for Carrie the film. And he and Michael Gore are a husband. And so they called me one day and said, we've written a musical based on Carrie. And I said, why? And I was just kidding them, you know, but they were like, oh, you're so mean. You know, they were like, it's great. It's going to be great. And I was like, okay. Mm-hmm. They said, we want you to meet with Terry Hands, the director from, you know, who's the head of the RSC. And I was like, okay. And so I had this meeting with Terry Hands, and it was like kind of bumpy. He was like, I hear you're afraid to fly. And I was like, what do you mean I'm afraid to fly? You know? And he said, well, in Cats, you made them, purchase a life insurance policy for you. And I said, well, you would too. I said, I didn't have any safety harnesses or anything. I was like up in space on those machines. And and he was just kind of very provocative. And it was odd because he was very good friends of Trevor Nunn's, and, you know, I worked for Trevor and stuff.
Yeah.
So it just was bumpy, and I felt really uncomfortable. And so we started our negotiation, and we literally couldn't come to terms. So I said, forget it, let it go. And it was funny because I had a big power broker agent at that point who was the same agent as the creative team. So we couldn't come to terms, and they then cast Barbara Cook and went to the RSC outside of London, and did the show, and it got horrible, horrible reviews, and she didn't want to come to Broadway with it. So they called me again and said, we'd like to fly you to London to see the show. And I was like, okay. And then it was like, no, we'll send you the video. And I was like, okay. So I saw it and I was like, yeah, I think I know what to do with this. You know, she was beautiful, Barbara Cook, and just absolutely sang it gloriously, but was very stationary in the part. And I felt like it deserved a more athletic kind of crazed interpretation, which I later brought to it. So we started negotiating again, still couldn't come to terms. And our mutual agent called me right before they opened on Broadway or went into rehearsal and said, Betty, if you don't go in, all these people will be out of work. and this is the deal I've got for you. And I'm like, okay, I'll go in. So I did, and it was an incredible work situation. It was just wonderful. And I'm very, very proud of what we created in terms of the reality quotient, the authenticity of an abusive mother and mm-hmm. daughter in that situation, an abused child and an abusive mother. And Lindsay and I are still very close friends from that experience. The German producer had spent all his money in England, and he hadn't allowed for a PR campaign to move it forward. I mean, the truth is, we didn't just get bad reviews. We got great reviews. We got some mediocre reviews and some bad, but he needed like a bunch of money to push it past the reviews. And so there was a man named Bruce Mailman, who was the owner of the Saint downtown, which is this very crazy club, gay club that I sang Memory one New Year's Eve there. It was like everybody, it was so wild. And, people are like, I remember when you sang Memory at the Saint, you had on this like sequin gown. And I was like, okay. And Jane Greenwood, I called her. I said, what do I wear to sing Memory at the Saint? And she's like, the brilliant costume designer. She said, oh, we'll put you in a skirt and boots and a sweater with some sparkle on it, and everybody will think you wore a beaded gown. And sure enough, it was so funny. So he was going to give him the money to push past the reviews. And at the end of the Saturday matinee, it was all going to happen. And I think we'd opened, you know, a couple of days before or the day before. And so the creators all were flying back to L.A. By the time we got back to the Saturday night show from our dinner break, they posted the closing notice because the advisors to the German producer had taken him inside and said, you know, your house is, you know, you double mortgaged your house. It's like, you can't continue. Yeah. And so they just pulled the plug. It was unfortunate because
too bad.
It was the hottest ticket in New York, and it was so crazy. And people would talk to us during the show. Literally. It was so much fun.
Well, it caused such a response, not only the movie, but the musical as well. I mean, I remember when I was in college, people being obsessed with it, you know, and it was so culty. It had this really cult undertone to it, I guess, because it was so short-lived and had this sort of, you know, it died too young, so to speak. But then, of course, they did the revival off-Broadway. So people have always wanted to, like, make it right or somehow. Mm-hmm.
It's a difficult piece to produce, but it's a wonderful piece at the same time. The music is out of this world.
It's out of this world. It's so good. People used to sing it all the time, probably mainly because they were like, do you know what this is from? Not many people do. But it was
I love
music.
How many people I meet in the world and are like, oh, I saw you in Carrie. And I'm like, did you?
You were like, did you though?
I'm not so sure.
That's hilarious. Okay, and then, of course, you and I met doing Sunset Boulevard.
Yes, we
there
did.
There you are as Norma Desmond. God, you killed it in that show. And I, sadly, only got to do the show with you for about a month. But you were it was revitalizing and exciting when you came into the show.
Thank you.
You know,
I was sad when you left. I was like, why is she leaving so soon? You were like,
you know, Betty,
the hot yen thing.
Well, I think about this all the time. I mean, and I tell the story, and I made it up in my head, but I was the first ensemble member to leave Sunset Boulevard, and it was about a month into your run. And you were so nice to me. You were so incredibly giving and sweet, and you... you took pictures, a bunch of Polaroid pictures of us backstage, which I have some. Here, Charlie, mm-hmm. will you show? Look, that is us.
Oh, look, backstage. That's cool.
Isn't that hilarious? And me and that, like,
it's
the
so
ladies.
It's so cute. You got to take a picture of that and send me that, would you?
I will. I have a couple other ones. I have like 8 of them. They're just, it's so funny.
Cute.
There we are being absolutely ridiculous. But I remember, I also remember that, well, there I am being ridiculous. You can take that one off. Bye.
That's a cute costume, isn't it?
I know, isn't it so cute? But we, and the ladies
Did you know
paying,
that Anthony Powell passed away?
When did he pass away?
Yeah, it was just online today. I don't know the details.
Oh.
I know. I'm sorry. So I should have told you before.
I loved him so much.
I just thought of it because of that beautiful dress there that you were wearing.
He was so incredible. Oh, that's so sad. I'm so sorry to hear that. Mm-hmm. I spent time with him also when I went to London to do South Pacific with Trevor. He didn't design, but I spent a lot of time with him there. Oh, his work was so stunning, not only in theater, but in films as well. Oh, my gosh.
Anthony Powell. I did one film with him, Frantic, with Harrison Ford, and Anthony did the clothes for that. He was a wonderful man, really lovely.
Yeah, he really was. Oh, my gosh. Rest in peace. Sweet, sweet man.
Rest in peace.
Well, we got to wear his beautiful things. I feel so lucky that I got to be a part of that show and wear his gorgeous clothes.
Too.
He made me look, you know, thinner than I really was. Anyway, you also, the thing I remember the most, well, two things about that night. We were taking these pictures, and I was like, Betty, well, you're being so nice to me. Why are you being so nice to me? And you were like, nice begets nice. And I'll never forget that. I'll never forget that you said that to me. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, right. Like, be nice to people. People be nice to you. That was cool that you said that to me. I loved that. And then during As If We Never Said Goodbye, you turned around and sang, like, part of the song to me. And I was, like, in tears. And
I know. I was sad you were going. I just thought you were such a light in the show.
You're like, so sweet. It was so lovely. And it was just one of those moments in a lifetime. And I've had a number of other, you know, Broadway shows since then, but that is one of the moments that really stands out to me as being incredibly impactful and something I'll never,
thank
ever,
you. That's
ever
so
forget.
Nice.
Oh, it's true. It was really a wonderful thing. It was a gift that you gave me, and I really appreciate it. It was awesome.
Thank you, Lauren. Did you go on to another project? Is that why you left?
I did.
Well, what were you doing?
I mean, I went to do 9 at Paper Mill. Like, I went to play Carla at Paper Mill.
Cool.
And I think it, you know, you, when you were talking about you did Pippin for 2.5 years or 2+ years, you know, I had done Sunset Boulevard in L.A., and then I'd done it in New York for another 10 months. I just felt like I was ready to play a role, and it didn't matter where it was. It didn't have to be on Broadway. It didn't have to be anywhere. I just was really looking forward to playing a part because I had been in the ensemble. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I loved it. I loved my time doing it. But I was just ready to sort of see, like, if I had what it took to play a role. And so I got this opportunity at Paper Mill to play a role, and I went and did it. And then, as you know, I went on to play Betty Schaefer on the tour like a year later. But so I had a long history with Sunset Boulevard. I'm so grateful
Sunset.
For it.
Yeah, I loved it. The 2 years I did it, a year in London and a year on Broadway. And it was perfect. It was amazing.
Yeah,
I just enjoyed it so much.
Spectacular. I mean, your voice.
Thank you.
Your vulnerability, your acting was, you know, who'd you say? Brian De Palma said, are you a good actor? Are you a good singer?
Bruce Beresford.
Well, you're right. You were all those things. I mean, your vulnerability and it just was so fragile. It was so interesting. And it was like a masterclass watching you get to, you know, watching you play
Thanks,
that part.
Lauren.
Up
Thank
close
you.
And personal.
Thank you very much.
And what else did you do? You, of course, then... What's next? Hello Dolly, not Hello Dolly. That was just recently. I'm just looking at pictures.
After Sunset, I did Gypsy at the.
Triumph of Love is what I was.
Oh, I did Triumph of Love. Yeah,
right.
That
with
was
Susan Egan.
That was
that was a great
experience.
And then I remember seeing you in Gypsy at Paper Mill. You were incredible. You were fabulous.
Thank you.
And then of course you've done a number of films since, and you. I'm thinking you're M. Night Shyamalan's. Did I say that right? Nope.
Shyamalan.
You're one of his favorite people ever.
Shyamalan.
Thank you. I'm stupid. Please, I hope he doesn't see this.
No.
But you did Split, and then of course you did The Happening as well. So you've done.
Yeah,
tons
The Happening.
And tons and
the
tons.
Happening was first, and then. He wrote the role in Split for me, which was very amazing.
Oh, that is amazing.
Yeah,
that
it was lovely.
Amazing.
Well, the truth is that in M. Night Shyamalan, in every one of his movies, there's a white-haired woman he kills. And she always dies, right? She's always this main character,
yes.
And she always dies.
Hilarious.
And so I had been up for his wonderful casting guy, Doug Abel. I'd auditioned for any number of his previous films and always came close and never got the part. So I was up for the role in The Happening. And I was like, So I read the script and he had this like notion of the character as he wrote it. And I thought, he doesn't really mean that. He means I know what he wants. And so I decided to give him like the kind of the opposite of what he wrote. It was hilarious. And so my assistant, Kathy, who, you know, she's worked with me for now almost 21 years. So it was right after I had moved to the ranch and here in Texas. And so we, you know, nobody had iPhones back then and stuff. And so we went to the camera store and we bought this really good camera. And the guy said, yes, it's compatible with a Mac computer. It's easy to download the video from that. And I was like, okay. So poor Kathy, whenever I have to do these auditions, she has to read opposite me. And I'm like, look at my eyes, for God's sake. She goes, I'm holding a camera, for God's sake. And it's like, it's always a nightmare. It creates a lot of stress. And so we did this video for The Happening, and I played it like this really creepy character. And so then Kathy's like trying to download it. And I go off after we finish the audition, I go off to ride my horses. I'm in the back pasture with my horses. And Kathy's like, we had Blackberries. And so she calls me on my Blackberry and she says, I can't download this. And I was like, oh my God, go to Fort Worth to the camera store and get that guy to download it, take the computer. So she, you know, goes driving off fast and the guy's not there and nobody at the camera store knows what to do. And she calls me with her BlackBerry again and says, I don't know what to do. And I'm like, so go to FedEx. And she goes, we have a deadline. We have to do this. I don't know how to do this. And so we agreed that she would bubble wrap the camera and send the whole camera to New York. And I said, in the meantime, we'll email Doug Abel and say, you've got some techie that can download this because we can't. Right. So we did, and Doug he thought it was hilarious that we sent our whole expensive little camera. And so a couple of days later, they're like, oh, Knight needs to meet you. So they flew me into New York to meet him, and he comes into the room, and he's like, you sent the camera?
Oh, my God, that is everything.
I said, what we had to? We didn't know what to do. We wouldn't make your deadline. He goes, you sent the camera? And I was like, yeah, you know, we want to work with you. And so he was like, he liked that. And he goes, okay, well, the reason I wanted to tell you, she kills herself by pushing her head to, you know, bashing her head through a glass window. Do you have a problem with death scenes? And I said, did you see the film Carrie? I said, a basketball backboard cuts me in half. No, I don't have a problem with death scenes. You know, it was hilarious.
Oh,
so anyway, I did The Happening with Mark Wahlberg and Zooey Deschanel and John Leguizamo. So it was so fun. And then he did Split with the wonderful James McAvoy. Oh my God, is he divine? Mm. And so he wrote it for me and I was like, oh my God, this is great.
I mean, that is pretty cool when you have a director who's just like, love you so much, here, I'm gonna write you a thing.
Yeah, I know, cool. That was so special.
What do you think is the difference between your, well, I guess I have two questions. One, is there a difference to you in terms of acting for stage and acting for film? And then my follow-up question is do you prefer one or the other?
I don't think there's a difference. I mean, I was listening to your interview with Kelly O'Hara, and she doesn't think so either. It's just all about proportion. So you know where your canvas is. You know, you know whether it's like here or if there's more space. Mm-hmm. The reality quotient of the truth of how you work on character is exactly the same. It's just when you're connecting with a theater of 2,000 people or, you know, 1,500 people or something, there's an immediacy that's very thrilling to work with a live audience. I mean, film is the director's medium, and so I can't, you know, I can influence, but I can't control the outcome. I just have to be sure that, you know, I hit all the marks, and not just physical marks, but the marks that I mean to hit in the evolution of the character, and hope that the director perceives it with the kind of sensitivity that I, you know, would hope that they would receive it.
Right.
And so that's cool.
That is interesting.
But the same work goes into it. It's just a different, you know, whether it's here or whether there's more space.
Yeah. And when you were, I mean, so you've said that you're from Texas. You grew up in Big Spring, Texas. Is that right?
I mean, I was born in Big Spring, but basically I started school in Morocco, North Africa, when I was five, six, and seven. My dad was in the Air Force. And then we moved back to Texas, to Fort Worth, when I was in the third grade. And then we were stationed in Loring, Maine, near Caribou, Maine, for my fourth grade year. And then my fifth grade year, my dad didn't want the family to keep being moved around. Mm-hmm. Although I was really grateful that we got all that experience and perspective of the world being a bigger place than just Fort Worth, Texas, you know, having been an Air Force brat. So he retired from the Air Force and became a college professor when I was in the fifth grade. And so I then stayed in Fort Worth through fifth and sixth grade, junior high, high school, and then I went to TCU.
Wow.
Which is in Fort Worth. Yeah.
So it's so interesting because what comes to mind is how does a little girl from Fort Worth, Texas, even understand that acting and singing is a career path? Like, was your family involved?
And yeah.
What mm-hmm. was your first love? Singing or acting?
Well, I sung in church. My dad taught me South Dakota folk songs. He had an old guitar and we had a funky old piano in the garage, and he could play all that by ear. And so I remember some of my first singing experiences were with him singing these old folk songs. And then I sang in the youth choir in church. My mother had been a singer dancer when she was a kid and she loved it. And my aunt had been a professional dancer and then had her own dance studio. So I'd been studying dance with my aunt since I was three. My mother had this really vast collection of Broadway cast albums and albums by great lady singers. And so I was very up on what Broadway was and what, you know, from just being, and she was always singing around the house, and my brothers and I had three younger brothers. We loved it. And she took me to my first musical when I was 11, which was a pajama game at the Casa Manana summer musicals. And the two guys, when I saw Steam Heat with the girl and the two guys in the black suits and the bow ties and the derby hats, you know, I was like, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen, right? And I had this like transcended experience of this energy force going up through the top of my head and kind of looking back at me and saying, that's it. That's what you're going to be doing for the rest of your life. And I was like, what is it? And they were like, yo, it's musical theater. So yeah, there it is.
that's you practicing Steam Heat. That is so cool to have a moment like that of just like divine, like, this is it. There's no turning back. I know exactly what that is. Wow.
So we had this junior high talent show called The Morning Follies, and I wanted to be in the show. So I told my mother I wanted to learn Steam Heat. And the two guys that were responsible, the choreographer and lead dancer, were a couple. And they decided they were tired of touring, and they had been acolytes of Fosse's. Mm-hmm. So they opened the school in Fort Worth at the same week that I told my mother I wanted to learn the number. And she was so excited. She took me to them and they were like, yeah, we can teach it to you. And so I learned it with the original hat tricks and the dance and everything. And I was the 11 o'clock number in the junior high talent show. And
of course
it
you were.
Brought the house down. And then after that, you know, it was like my mother entered me in everything. I didn't like the competitive aspects of all that, but you know, so I've been performing regularly since I was 11 and professionally since I was 15 at CASA. Wow. I did Dainty June and Gypsy one summer and danced a West Side Story. And then after that, I did a show for Casa Manana every summer. So
I love it. That's
I had
so
a lot
cool.
of a lot of performing experience.
Oh, that's amazing. So it was sort of like meant to be that you stayed there and you didn't end up traveling, because that was probably very informative for you.
We
talked a lot about It Is Enough at the top of the show, but I did want to roll a little video because I want everybody to see you in your glory. This is Betty Buckley and Dick Van Patten from It.
I'm going to be a guidance counselor.
Oh, yay! You're going to be a guidance counselor.
At Memorial High.
Memorial High? That's the worst school in the whole city. A teacher was stabbed there last week.
No. But I need a job.
But you're overqualified. You're a PhD. You're trained to teach in college. You'll find a job.
Tom, they're not hiring in colleges. They're laying off.
They'll hire again.
Sure. If another baby boom gets underway tonight, they'll be hiring in about 18 years.
But Abby,
Take that back. Make it 19 years.
I'm scared for you. I don't want you in the middle of a potentially violent situation.
I can handle it.
Are you sure?
I'm sure.
Well, that makes one of us.
So good. Betty Buckley, you're so gorgeous. I can't handle it. It's just so cool that you were able to have that kind of experience where your Broadway career really kicked off this television and film career for you as well. I mean, that alone is like something that you dream about, and it only happens to very few people. How were you able to keep like a level head, and kind of sort of what we were talking about with when Cats opened on Broadway and the Tender Mercies came out, how were you able to maintain, you know, the rigorous 8-show-a-week routine and do all the press and things like that? And do you have, you know, advice or like ideas around how people can do that as they're moving forward with their careers?
I was so thrilled to be doing Cats because all I ever wanted to do was be in the musical theater. And when I accepted the job on Eight Is Enough, it was a bit shocking to discover that doing a TV series is like working in a factory. And our producers weren't very nice people either. They were really mean and very cruel and psychologically manipulative. And I had to end up hiring a big attorney to represent me, to protect me from them. And it was like this huge school of big business, show business. And The whole time I was on Eight Is Enough, I was going to my dailies to study my work because I knew I was an okay actress. I was a very average actress, but I wanted to become a really good actress. And so I was studying with Stella Adler and taking her script analysis classes at night and going to my dailies every day and studying my work on film and saying, okay, there were 10 seconds that were real there. Why did that work? And why does this not work? And just taking myself apart to learn to become a better actress. And so that went on for 4 years. And Eight Is Enough was a wonderful school in that way. I felt like it was like getting my master's degree, so to speak. I became a good actress. And I needed that practice. And we were doing 29 episodes a year, which took a week and a half to shoot one episode for 4 years, which was a huge schedule. But I had no life. I would run and meditate in order to survive the psychological pressure of doing that show. And as I was meditating and learning to meditate, I learned the application of meditation and the focus of in meditation to bringing it to my work. And my work just became better and better. And so then when I got out of Eight Is Enough, when the show was finally canceled, I got, fortunately, through divine intervention, he truly was Tender Mercies. And they didn't let me see my dailies until the end. And they brought me in one Saturday and showed all my footage to me, all my scenes back to back. And there was a lot more that didn't make the film. So I got to really see, and I suddenly was sitting there and saw my work on film and thought, oh, I learned how to do this, you know? And it was like so exciting, you know, because they were all very proud of me and proud for me that I had turned in this very authentic performance of an alcoholic country Western star who's, you know, it was a fabulous role written by Horton. It was the kind of part that I had aspired to play that like Horton Foote wrote for all my favorite actresses, which were Kim Stanley and Geraldine Page. And, you know, it was like, I'm working with that guy.
Yeah,
you know,
that's pretty cool.
And then opposite Robert Duvall is one of our great, great actors.
Yeah.
So I learned so much, you know, it was just like such a blessing. And then from there got Cats. And my aspiration, Lauren, had been to be, to bring a level of truthful, reality-based acting to the musical theater. That was what my burning ambition was, to bring truth to the musical theater. So Grizabella was the first time I had a role where I could do that, you know, where I could work with that kind of soul revelation. And that was incredible. So the attention I received from both of those things, that phenomenal year that they both, like Tender Mercies was released after Cats had opened, and then the Tony nomination and all that was amazing. And there was, on the heels of that success, I got a lot of offers that I couldn't deal with, like a big fancy manager who was a manager for a big country western star, among other people, wanted to manage me. And I was like, I said no, because I didn't have a vision beyond learning to become a better actor. Mm. You know, that was all I'd worked on. And yeah. So I turned some things down. I turned down a TV series. I turned down several big opportunities because I just wanted time to grow and let my career just continue to unfold in its own natural way, yeah. Which was kind of interesting, you know, to me. That was my choice.
It's a lot of foresight for somebody who was young. You know.
Well, I was at that point. I was like 35, and I was just like, I need time to grow. I don't know. I still don't know exactly who I am. I know I've become a better actor, and that was my goal. But I'm still not sure exactly who I am. So
it's so cool though that you were like, I just want to be a better artist, and it wasn't about like, oh, I'm going to grab the next thing that's going to make me a huge star. And right. Therefore, you have always been able to hold on to the authenticity that you do have and your integrity as a performer. I think that's actually a really cool story. And you've done
Thanks.
Good.
It's okay. What I like about my career is that it's very eclectic. And it's eclectic. I like that about it, that it mm-hmm. seems to have its own little path. So
yeah,
that's nice.
I mean, it's very exciting to have seen what you've done and all the different levels that you've done it on. So I think you made a wonderful choice. And again, I think for the artists who are listening today, it's incredible to hear that you cared about the craft.
Thanks.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So I do want to bring out the artists, because this kind of parlays us right directly into the fact that you have been a teacher too throughout a lot of this. So your career has not only been about performing, but it's also about giving to the next generation. Mm-hmm. And so part of the show is we like to bring out three aspiring artists one at a time to be able to talk with you and ask questions and you advise, et cetera. So we have three incredibly talented gals with us tonight. The first is Supriya Jaya, who has worked at Theatre Raleigh, and she is an incredible singer, incredible actress, and I thought it would be fun for her to get to have a chance to say hi and talk to you. Supriya, this is Betty.
Hi, Supriya.
Betty, Supriya.
Hello. It is
nice to meet
so
you.
Fabulous to be here. Nice to meet you. Thank you, Lauren, for the opportunity, and Betty for just being here. Thank you.
So do you have a question you want to ask Betty?
Yeah. That last part you guys were just talking about is just, it hits right on the nail as to where my question was going. As you know, COVID-19 has affected every actor in at least some form, if not the largest form. And a lot of us are experiencing a lull right now, a big lull. And I was wondering if you've ever experienced a lull in your career that made you question your performances or your career in the future, and how it affected you, and maybe what advice you would give to someone who's experiencing this lull. Obviously, it's a little different because this one's forced upon us, but just in general, I'm curious to see if you've experienced something like that.
Yeah, I went through a period of time right before I got Sunset Boulevard where, I mean, I couldn't get a job, and my power broker agent dropped me. I'll never forget the day. I remember the quality of light coming through the window. I remember what my hands looked like on my desk, and his assistant called, or assistant to assistant called, and said, we're dropping you as a client. And I was like, whoa, you know, mm-hmm. and it was really like shocking. And so for the first time in my whole career, I had to go shop for an agent. And I had been signed by my first agent when I was 18 and I was still in college. And so I'd never done that. And I'd met all these people in the business that I'd literally grown up with in the business, who I witnessed sitting opposite them at various desks, enjoying saying no to me. Like, the sadism was unbelievable. And I was just in shock that this, at this time period, and it was so, confusing. And I was this meditator and living this very, you know, completely committed to my meditation and yoga and my life. And so I did this, it's a long story. I'll try to shorten it up, but my brother called me in the process. There was this big event at Carnegie Hall. Again, I had not been included in, and then at the last minute, someone fell out, and I was invited to be in it. And over the course of the week, the New York Times came out with this big review, and I was the only artist in the show they didn't mention. And my brother called me, and I did a good job in the show too, and at this last minute thing. And my brother called me and said, I'm gonna read you this thing. It's like when everything in your life is saying you're someone you're not, that means that your spiritual practice is going very well. And he said, so Betty Lynn, I think you're about to hit nirvana. And it was very funny. By the end of the week, the magazines came out, Newsweek, New York Magazine, Time Magazine. And they all talked about the moment in the concert as being this moment that I had experienced with this in the show. And so it was like it flipped. And then right after that, I got this job up at Williamstown. And I was, you know, or I was in rehearsals for that. So that went very well. And shortly after that, I literally did this prayer where I said, God, it's me, your friend Betty. And I just want to tell you that I love musical theater more than anything, but this is like weird. And so if you want me to go somewhere else, if you want me to go teach at a university, if you want me to go be, you know, sing in this church choir, whatever it is, just tell me, because I've had this great career. And I'm, you know, I'm delighted. I just want to serve, but I feel like I brought my talent to this place and expertise to this place that I know I can serve very well in this arena. But if that's not the plan, just show me what the plan is. Just tell me where I'm supposed to go. And right after that, a couple of days later, I got the call to be flown to London to audition for Sunset Boulevard. And then I got that and was in London for a year and then on Broadway for a year. It just flipped. Like, but it felt very much that the reason it flipped is because I completely surrendered to whatever it was that I was meant to do in terms of service. And in regarding the pandemic, so I started teaching on Zoom last April, so for a year now. And that's been an amazing experience to teach on Zoom. I've been a teacher for 47 years or more. But this Zoom thing was working very, very well. And in the process of doing that, like during the campaign, I decided I was going to make this video. So I had this idea of this hymn for the beauty of the earth. And then this hymn I grew up with called Jesus Loves the Little Children. And I reached out to this wonderful school called SAE School in San Diego and got these guys. I said, I want your kids to sing this with me. And they were like, yeah, we'll do that. And so then I got my collaborator, Christian, to create the arrangement for it. So it was really modern and beautiful, not like it was done previously. And then I called my friend Matt Amato in Minneapolis. And I said, I want you to help me, you know, collate this video and bring this together for the campaign. So I put my own money into it and created this video. It was the first time I'd done something like that. And then I wrote this story that I had Christian score like a movie. That's this beautiful little story. And I realized after I finished it and after we recorded it, that it's an animated short film. So I'm producing my first film. So my therapist says she's really proud of me because I keep creating stuff, you know? And so I'm producing this film and I'm really excited about it. It's a beautiful story and it's a really lovely piece. And I just keep following my next creative impulse, you know? And, you know, it's like, I think that's all you can do. I don't think you can, is it Supriya?
Supriya.
I don't think you can, like, just wait for the world to come to you. I think you really have to think in terms of being in service and trying to create things that are inspiring for people and will help them feel better about themselves and their experience in the world. I mean, that's what Lauren Kennedy Brady is doing. She's like creating a theater. And so, you know, it's all about service. And that's what I teach my students anyway.
Well, I think it's also really cool that you said a little bit of the surrender and that spirituality and kind of aligning with yourself, but also The fact that if you stay creative and you say yes to things, you know, the fact that you said yes to that concert at Carnegie Hall, which maybe you hadn't been invited to, but you didn't have an ego about it. You said yes, you did it. And then it opened up doors in a way. So I love that. I love telling students to say yes to things because you never know what's going to come out of it, you know, so.
Yeah, but I also think it's about having no expectation of things being as you, I had my point. Oh, well, it's like, I think the notion of being an instrument of higher consciousness in the, in the world and really having a constant prayer of let me be of use, let me be of service. And what I teach my students in terms of the use of meditation and how to make their choices using a universal spiritual philosophy is to make yourself an instrument and then to listen for your inner guidance and become a necessary artist. A necessary artist will be called because our job is to serve the community. And so, especially now more than ever, I mean, the world is, to quote Thornton Wilder, the world is at sixes and sevens, it's upside down. And so everything that we can do as storytellers to help people remember who we are as a humanity, as a human family, we will be called to serve. So I think it's really important not to get stuck in my life has to look like this, my career has to look like that, but just to hone your skills, keep practicing and do what you can do to create the next story that will be beneficial to those who witness it or hear it. Or that's the next song that will be helpful.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Well, thank you, Supriya, for being with us. I appreciate it so much. Supriya is a shining
Thanks,
star.
Supriya.
She's got a lovely career ahead of her. Thank you. And our next artist I'm going to bring out is, Natalia Soto. I'm going to bring out Natalia to say hi to Betty and ask her question.
Hi Natalia.
Hi, Lauren. Hi, Betty. I'm really excited that you're here.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too. You had a phenomenal answer for Supriya's question, and it's clear that you have so much insight and are a phenomenal teacher. I've already learned so much in this character building already.
Thank you.
And you actually kind of touched on my question a little bit. I'm in the Raleigh area. I'm an actor. I sang, and I've dabbled in writing. And I like to make bold choices on stage. You know, boldness is rewarded in acting. But I find that I sometimes struggle to make those bold choices off the stage in terms of the career and the direction that I want to go in. And especially facing the uncertainties, I do the same, meditate and focus and try and find where I'm being called to go in my career. And I sometimes feel like it backfires, or I sometimes feel like I'm not headed in the direction that I need to go into. So you mentioned before that you turned down some offers so you could focus on the craft. And I'm just wondering what philosophy or what guiding principles you have to help navigate those moments when you make a bold choice in your career and it doesn't necessarily pan out the way you think it will.
Well, that's a good question. So that comes back to this notion of expectation, right? So we don't know why one thing works and why something else doesn't. What I forgot to add previously to that small discussion we were having is that it's very important for you to not take to heart the opinions that other people have about you, whether it's your family, your friends, your boyfriend, girlfriend, all your, you know, companions, teachers. There's all kinds of people in this business who will say no to you, and gladly so, because they're frustrated for whatever reasons and it has nothing to do with you. I mean, if I wrote a book about every unkind thing that's ever been said to me about myself personally and about my work in the process, I'd be like, oh, forget it, you know? So when you say you don't, I don't know exactly what you're referring to when you say your bold choices don't seem to be fulfilling the expectations as you're thinking they should. Somebody sent me a book recently that was like, don't listen to anybody, right? Don't listen to anybody. Like, pick and choose, you know, and learning, there's another book, like learning how to not give a fuck, excuse my language, but it's like, you know, it's like, that's literally a book. It's truly. Like, I don't know if I'm saying the title properly, but I have that book too.
And so it should be that if it's not.
It's like, it's really important for you to pick and choose very carefully who you listen to, starting with your own inner awareness. If you think you did something well, then you did, right? And then picking and choosing very carefully. And I'm fortunate in that I've always known how to pick teachers, right? So I know when I'm hearing something that's not accurate, and I know when I'm hearing something that is pertinent and that I should really attend to. Mm. And I've been very fortunate to have teachers that are incredible. So picking good teachers, good coaches that really, that you can trust, that where you really value what they have to tell you. But when you say you're concerned about the bold choices and you're not getting whatever, I don't know, maybe you could eliminate what that is exactly. You're not getting the results you expect or want. Is that, what is that exactly?
Yeah, I think sometimes, like you mentioned before, deciding which projects you want to pursue and which projects or offers you want to turn down, and navigating screen and stage and making those choices. I find that like sometimes I'll pursue one of those paths and then find that maybe I should have done the other one and maybe it was the wrong choice. Mm. Or maybe if I had done the other one, that sort of guidance.
Well, that's kind of a waste of time, because if you've made a choice and then you're after the fact say, well, I should have done the other, it's too late, right? So yeah. It's like, why would you beat yourself up about that? You know, it's like, you know, no, next. And show business is like, it, you know, it's so filled with rejection. It's and it's filled with unkindness. And it's also filled with kindness. I mean, I'm an actor whose career literally is about kind people who've opened doors for me, you know. Mm. But I've also learned about unkind people that have slapped me upside the head in many ways, that kicked my ass in many ways that weren't conducive, you know. And so learning to go within. And I think one of the beauties of getting older is that my own taste to me, I believe in what the accumulation of a lifetime of practice has brought me. I trust my inner self. So learning to meditate and really listening to that soul that is you, Natalia, your own soul, your own higher awareness, your own higher consciousness, right? That says, Natalia, this, not that. Learning to discern what that is and hearing it beyond the voice of your personality. That's hard to do, but over time you can learn to do that. But don't waste time with second thoughts, because it's already passed. The ship has sailed.
And to add to that too, Natalia, is that, you know, it might not reveal itself right away why you made that choice, or it might not feel right at first, but it will come to fruition later that it is. It's what Betty was talking about, is being, you know, in line with yourself and knowing yourself for sure.
It's also knowing what you really want for yourself, which takes time too. How old are you, Natalia?
I'm 24.
24. So when I was 24, you know, I had certain ideas of who I thought I was in the musical theater. But the truth was, beneath all those ideas, there was this deep passion to become a certain quality of actress and storyteller. And so there were a series of opportunities that I thought certain parts were mine. You know, like I thought, I've got this. And I was called back in one case 9 times, another time 6 times. It was ridiculous. And then I didn't get it. Instead, I got this like movie, and then I got this TV show, which was like a really hard experience. But the inner dream was to become a better actress. So I was literally put into a work situation where to survive it, I had to learn all the skills that taught me to be a better actor, right? I had to learn meditation. I became a runner. I was all about focus. It was all about commitment and focus. And I came out the other side of that with the skill set that I'd aspired to, that previously when I didn't get those jobs, I thought it was all that, but I wasn't, you know, it was inside me, but it hadn't manifested itself. It was potential. But I hadn't grown into that potential yet, because I hadn't learned everything I had to learn. So sometimes I think that's what Lauren was perhaps saying. Sometimes that life situation I was put in that wasn't necessarily the most pleasant thing at the time, it forced me to grow,
right? Because if I didn't grow, I would introvert and just like dissolve, right? So I was forced to get stronger, 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 become better, better, better at my craft. And so it was a good thing, right? So while I was in it, I was like, what, this, that, you know, but I came out the other end and I was like, yes, you know? So like, you don't always know. Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And hopefully we come out of the pandemic and we get that. Yeah. At the very end, I really appreciate everything that you've said. It has really resonated, and it's just been so insightful and wonderful to have you. I really appreciate, thank you. And thank you, Lauren, for having me. We love Lauren in Theater Raleigh. Everyone donate.
Yeah. Everyone donate. Duh. Thank you, Natalia. And I will see you soon. Natalia. Thanks. Nat is going to be in one of our shows this summer. Very excited.
Great. What
show? And she's going to be doing our Broadway concert, which is called Oh, What a Night. So it's just a celebration. Yeah, that's how we're sneaking back in with just a big Broadway extravaganza.
Oh, that sounds great.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. And also in that show is going to be our next young actress. Her name is Sarah Bach. Sarah, we'd love you to join us. Hi, girl.
Hi, Sarah. Hi.
How are you? Sarah, you want to tell Betty a little bit about yourself?
Sure. I'm Sarah. I'm 14. I'm a freshman in high school, and I am aspiring to be an actress as my career.
So do you have a question for Betty?
Yes. So my question is, in the industry, there's like a lot of opportunities to get inside your own head and to start comparing yourself to others. So what is a setback or challenge or rejection you faced, and how did you overcome it and find ways to grow from it?
That's a good question, Sarah. Thank you very much. So there are so many experiences of rejection. It's like part of being an actor is learning how to deal with rejection. And so even though when you know that like a certain job, you're like, oh, I got to get this. It's going to be great. I know I can do this. And then boom, you don't get it, right? So part of the challenge of being an actor is learning how to process rejection fast, right? Because there's no time to dwell on those losses. And there will be many. There'll be many, many, many. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're just absolutely mind-boggling at how many there are. And then suddenly you'll turn a corner and the thing that is meant to be yours just is yours. And it seems really magical in that way. So part of the rejection that's good is that it really illuminates the magic when the magic happens, right? So learning to process rejection is super important. And the ways I do that is let myself feel it fully when it happens. The disappointment, the anger, the feeling of loss, and I process it fast. I go for a walk. In the old days, I used to go for a run, a really fierce run, right? Or a bicycle ride. I walk my dog really fast. And if that doesn't do it, if there's like a series of callbacks that make me like, you know, really become attached to the project, then I beat my pillow. Or I take my pillow and beat the bed. And that really is also very good. Or I take a tennis racket and beat the bed, you know, so it's really important to process your emotions, right?
Get it out,
your disappointment, get out your anger, get out your frustration. So it's not good to dwell in disappointment or loss, right? It's good to process disappointment and loss. It's good to process rejection. It's like, boy, those guys, they don't know what they're talking about. Hit that pillow. You know? So get it out. So you go through it fast, right? And you get to the point where you're a real artist of processing rejection or disappointment with great lightning speed. That's part of the art of being an actor, is knowing that not everything is going to work out. Not everybody's going to love you. And there's a lot of weirdness in the business, but you learn how to keep going within yourself and trusting yourself and valuing yourself first and foremost, respecting yourself, respecting your craft. You worked really hard on it. You've practiced, you know what you're doing, and you're not going to take this no as an evaluation of your value. Does that help?
That is so good.
Thank you.
That is really, really good advice. It's so hard. And just in life, not even just in show business, but in life, to, you know, hold on to your value. So I'm so glad you said that. because hopefully that will mean something to you, Sarah, and you'll really hold on to that. Make sure that you heard Betty loud and clear that your value is so high and you're so beautiful and so incredible. And if you remember that there's a lot of work out there. You know, show business is plentiful. And so, you know, if you turn the tables and just think, well, that was just one of many, you know, and you can just...
Sarah, you have a great voice, so too.
I know, doesn't she?
Yeah. You have a great singing voice. You need to get a voiceover agent. You could do, like, amazing voiceovers for animated voices and stuff. It's a beautiful voice.
Yeah, she's
great.
Thank you. Great singer as well.
You're welcome.
Well, we're so happy we had you, Sarah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Of course. Bye.
Thanks,
bye,
Sarah.
Sweetheart. She's so very, very talented. I know, so talented too. This was just so insightful and great to hear all these things that you had to say to them. And obviously, we were just like catching up for so long, and we're kind of running out of time. But I do want to. I like to end the show with like a quick game of like rapid fire questions, where I'm going to ask you 10 questions. You have 10 seconds to answer. In 10 words or less, don't think too much about it. Just kind of like say what comes to your mind. Are you ready for this? It's very James Lipton.
Ready.
Okay,
here we go.
What accomplishment on stage are you most proud of?
Grizabella, Sunset Boulevard, and Edwin Drood.
There you go. What accomplishment off stage are you most proud of?
My ranch, my horses, the rescue animals that I've been rescuing and, you know, taking care of for the past 18 years.
Amazing. What is your fondest memory of your childhood?
Getting my first horse when I was 10. I browbeat my father into buying this horse for me. His name was Blaze.
We need to talk about how much you love horses. Oh my God, that's one of the things I've always remembered about you.
He literally rescued this horse, and he was my dream come true.
And there you are outside 1776 with a horse, of course.
Yeah.
If you could bring back one famous person from the dead, who would it be and why?
Ooh, that's interesting. Wow. Who could I bring back from the dead? Marilyn Monroe. I would like to pick her brain about the Actors Studio.
Ooh, very cool. That's a great answer. Oh my gosh, I love it. Okay, assume that you have a tombstone.
And
what would you like?
I would like to challenge her to not get involved with those weird entities.
No, oh my God, just don't do it. Don't do it.
Don't do it, Marilyn.
Okay, so assuming that you have a tombstone, what would you like engraved on it?
Oh, you done good, Betty Lynn.
There you go. Aside from the basic necessities, what do you need to be happy?
Oh, Colombian coffee from Zabar's every morning. Very important. Clean sheets. I really love clean sheets. And
so specific.
Yeah. And my super soft 90s, my super soft Hanes 90s.
I love it. Okay. It's all about sleeping and waking up. Love it. What positive adjectives would your friends and family use to describe you?
Oh, positive?
Yes.
Oh, that I'm, that I, they, well, bleh.
You got it.
I don't know. What would they, my friends and family, I think they would say that, you know, I'm kind of one pointed, I'm dogged, you know, I'm like, I'm like committed. I think they would say that. Maybe.
Committed is very positive. Well, then what would what would a negative adjective be that your friends and family would use to describe you?
That I'm bossy. They would definitely all say I'm bossy. All of them. They were like, you're so bossy.
I love it.
My mother was just this week. She was like, it's not your house, Betty Lynn. It's my house.
Amazing.
Leave me alone.
I'm like, your 95-year-old mother, right? She just had her birthday.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Great. And when I worked at Casa Manana, she was on the board of directors. I love your mom.
Yeah, yeah.
If you could live your life over, what would you do differently?
Oh, I don't know. I don't think I would do. I don't know.
You can say nothing. if you've got no regrets, that's amazing.
Well, I mean, I made some choices along the way. Certain boyfriends I should not have chosen.
And we'll just leave it there.
Yeah, I won't mention any names, but actually a majority of them.
Just could have done without.
Oh my God. No, that was a waste, absolute waste of time. Learned absolutely nothing. It's like, what the was I thinking?
Okay. And last but not least, have you read any good books or articles lately? Maybe the book, you shouldn't give up, bleep.
I got to go get those titles. I didn't quit. So I love any Michael Connelly book. And so I think he's got a couple of books or another book coming out soon. So when Michael Connelly has a new book, I am there. I'm like,
love it.
And
Michael Connelly.
I just depart from the world. Oh, you don't know Michael Connelly books? Oh my God.
Listen, Betty, I was not a big reader when I was younger, and now I just read scripts.
Oh, okay. You're busy.
Well, it's just like I should read more for fun. It's very true. I kind of embraced it in my early 20s, and then I've gone away from it because I do read so many scripts, and I just feel like I'd sometimes just rather watch Netflix. What can I say?
Ooh. Yeah, Netflix has got some great stuff, doesn't it?
I mean, it does. It really does. Oh, my God, this was so fun. All right, before we leave, we have to sign off with the iconic performance of Betty Buckley in the Tony Award-winning performance of Cats the Musical. Here she is. God, that is just incredible, Betty. That voice, oh my God.
Thank you.
It's just so stunning. I'll go ahead and say this, and just to embarrass my husband a little bit. I will admit, and he said earlier today that he teared up when he was editing that video together. He's a very tough, strong man, very manly, and he was in tears.
Aw, I mean, thank you.
Just so beautiful. And talk about fragile. They didn't want to cast you at first because you were like healthy and you were very fragile. And
thank you.
Just everything you had going on in your face, even behind the cat makeup, it's just so stunning. And you know what I'm most impressed with is the fact that you were in a squat when you sang Touch Me. Squat.
I'm pretty impressed with that myself.
Oh my God.
Like, that was hard. I had to work really hard to get enough leg strength to do that.
Like, is she literally in a squat and then she stands up on a high E? What is happening?
Yeah,
right
it was
now?
Like crazy.
Oh my God. People don't know. Audience, you need to know that not only singing that note, it was crazy and not many people can do it. And then she's also doing it in a full squat.
You want me to what? Like,
Okay. If anybody can do it, Betty Buckley can. Oh my God, this was so fun.
Work hard to do it. Thank you. It was really great talking to you, Lauren. Thank you for inviting me.
I've loved every second of it. I could talk to you all night. This has been a blast. And It's just been so great to hear your stories and hear more about you and your life and your career than I knew before. So thank you so much for sharing that with us
tonight.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure. Bring me back anytime.
Oh, yeah. All right. You guys, you
heard
her say
it. And bring me to Raleigh. I'd love to come work for you.
Seriously, that will happen. I'll have you come do a big concert or a play or something. Whatever you
say. Awesome. That would be great. Or I could direct something.
Can I direct something for you? Yes. Oh, my God. If you would do that, that'd be amazing. You heard it here, ladies and gentlemen. Donate to Theater Raleigh so we can afford to bring her.
Yes. Donate.
Donate. I love it. Thank you so much, Betty. It was so great to see you.
Thanks, Lauren. Take care.
Okay, you too. Bye. Have a good night. Maybe she'll come to Theater Raleigh. Oh, my God. That would be amazing. In any capacity, Betty Buckley in Raleigh, North Carolina. Ladies and gentlemen, you heard it. Oh, this is so fun. I'm so excited that you guys came and you were part of it tonight. We went long because she's so interesting and so incredible, and I felt so honored to have her. So thank you for watching. Next on Character Building, we have Raleigh's own Tony winner, Beth Level, is going to be with me May 25th at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'm really excited about Beth Level because she was my icon and my everything I wanted to be just like Beth Level. She went to my high school. She worked in the North Carolina Theater. She went to Broadway. She was a big deal. So I aspired to be her too. So she's going to come chat with me in a month. So join us for that on May 25th. And in the meantime, next Monday, we will be back here for Living Room Live with two of Theater Raleigh's favorites, Carrie Marshall and Estes Tarver. They're a married couple. They're incredible. We're going to talk. She's going to sing. It's going to be super cool. You're not going to want to miss that. So join us on April 26th. I had to read it as I was saying it. April 26th at 7:30. Thank you so much for being with us. Thank you so much for supporting live theater and loving this art form. I can't tell you how much we appreciate you. So everybody stay safe, wear your masks, and if you're eligible, get that vaccination so we can gather together and watch shows again. And we'll see you in this theater very, very soon. Good night.